am Ilaria Serra. I am an assistant professor at Florida Atlantic University, where I teach Italian studies. I teach Venice and its Reflection, and during my course we read a lot of literature and we also visit the places where literature took place. For example, the prisons from which Casanova escaped, or the house of Marco Polo, or the theaters where Goldoni's plays were shown. Behind this campo in Calle della Commedia, that's where Giacomo Casanova was born. He was the son of two actors. Casanova was the famous Venetian lover, more than anything. But he wrote the memoirs, the story of his life, where in pages and pages he told his entire life and all the stories of his loves. And this is where it all started, and it's maybe ironic that the name of Calle della Commedia is that, because he really wore so many masks in life. He was very self-confident, and also he was able to get on the horse of life, like he calls it. It's a horse, whatever horse passed by me, I would jump on it and run with it. So taking whatever fortune gave him and making the best out of it.
Casanova was just lucky enough I was not born yet. Otherwise, the competition would have been very hard for him.
Casanova's best line is Sequere Deum, or follow the gods.
I will begin with this confession. Whatever I have done in the course of my life, whether it be good or evil, has been done freely. I am a free agent. Man is free, but his freedom ceases when he has no faith in it. And the greater power he ascribes to his faith, the more he deprives himself of that gift which God has given to him when he endowed him with the gift of reason. Reason is a particle of the Creator's divinity. The reader of these memoirs will discover that I have never had any aim in my life, and that my system, if it can be called a system, has been to glide away unconcernedly on the stream of life, trusting to the wind wherever it led. It is only necessary to have courage, for strength without self-confidence is useless.
This bridge behind me is the Bridge of Fists, Il Ponte dei Pugni, where the two factions of Venetians would fight against each other and play while trying to throw one another down the bridge, because the railings are a new thing coming after Napoleon. Before that time, before 1800, all the bridges of Venice were without railings. So this was one of the big games that they would play. And the two factions were called Nicolotti and Castellani, and they would meet here. It was one of the ways to keep people happy and playful in the Venetian government. And also behind me, you can see the Campo San Barnaba, which is famous for two movies in particular, Indiana Jones and The Last Crusade. We have Indiana Jones coming out of the manhole behind me, pretending he's coming out from the library that is under this church, but there is no library under this church.
Venezia.
And another movie in 1954, Summertime, showed Katharine Hepburn falling in the water here in this canal. This is a campiello, what we call a campiello. There is a porta d'acqua over there, where the boats would stop, and the well, which probably was used by these houses only, probably a private well of this corte. It's Corte della Comare, and in corti like these, probably is where Carlo Goldoni's plays took place. So people would talk from one window to the other and have a very strong sense of community. Okay, this is a very famous crossing in the Grand Canal, and here you can see Palazzo Foscari, which today is the house of the University of Venice, but once in 1575 is where Veronica Franco met the King of France. Veronica Franco is maybe one of the most famous courtesans in the world because she was very strong-willed and she was also very cultivated, and she knew how to write well, and she answered also in her own defense.
Veronica, el restante mi chiamaste, aludendo a Veronica mio nome. I would like to ask you to recite the beginning of the canzoni you sent my way, since this written work is addressed to me.
Veronica, Veronica putana, franca, ed es furba, fina fiape e frola, e moffa e magra e marze e pi mariola, che si tra castel, ghetto e la duana.
Fairly unique, among other things you called me, alluding to Veronica, my name. And in your discourse, you blamed me severely. But according to my dictionary, I fail to see how one can properly call something unique, in a critical sense, by way of condemnation.
Che voria centenara di concetti e miara de pene e care mali e un numero infinito de poeti che volesse cantar i tutti i to mali tutte le toccae tutti i tu difetti spettava de ponti e de ospedali.
Perhaps you're speaking in an ironic way, but amphibology fails to communicate the point you evidently want to make. A woman whose fame makes her right to be proud, who stands out for beauty or for courage, and far exceeds all others in virtue. Such a woman is rightly called unique. And art, without irony, chooses to bestow this word, selected from others, upon her. And though you call me prostitute, either you imply that I'm not one of them, or that among them some merit praise. Whatever goodness prostitutes may have, whatever grace and nobility of soul, the sound of your word assigns to me.
Veronica.
If this was the purpose of your witty style, I'm happy not to raise objections, and I bow down, your humble and devoted servant. But since, reading carefully what you write, I find that in fact you're reproaching me, and this is clear, not a matter for debate. I distance myself from that purpose of yours. I insist on disputing it at any cost, and I long to give birth to the anger I breed. So make ready now your paper and ink, and tell me this time, without further delay, which weapons I must wield in combat with you. You will have nowhere to run from me, for I'm prepared for any test of skill, and I wait impatiently to start the fight.
Veronica.
There's nothing worse that can be done in life than to let oneself become a plaything of fortune, which can as easily or more easily hand out evil as good. But anyone with good sense, to avoid being deceived in the end, builds her hopes on what she has inside her and on what she might be able to make of herself. I'll add that even if fate should be completely favorable and kind to her, this is a life that always turns out to be a misery. It's a most wretched thing, contrary to human reason, to subject one's body and labor to a slavery terrifying even to think of. To make oneself prey to so many men, at the risk of being stripped, robbed, even killed, so that one day may snatch away from you everything you've acquired from many over such a long time, along with so many other dangers of injury and dreadful contagious diseases, to eat with another's mouth, sleep with another's eyes, move according to another's will, obviously rushing toward the shipwreck of your mind and your body. What greater misery, what wealth, what luxuries, what delights can outweigh all this? Believe me, among all the world's calamities, this is the worst. And if to worldly concerns you add those of the soul, what greater doom and certainty of damnation could there be?
This is Palazzo Mocenigo here at my shoulders, and this is where Lord Byron lived for several years, and he would come to Venice and find some healing for his soul, and he would also swim in the Grand Canal. At that time it was possible to do.
I stood in Venice on the Bridge of Sighs, a palace and a prison on each hand. I saw from out the wave her structures rise as from the stroke of the enchanter's wand. 1,000 years their cloudy wings expand around me and dying glory smiles, or the far times when many a subject land looked to the winged lion's marble piles, where Venice sate in state, throned on her 100 isles. She looks a sea Sibyl, fresh from the ocean, rising with her tiara of proud towers, at airy distance with majestic motion, a ruler of the waters and their powers. And such she was, her daughters had their dowers from spoils of nations and exhaustless east. Poured in her lap all gems and sparkling showers, in purple was she robed, and of her feast monarchs partook and deemed their dignity increased. In Venice, Tasso's echoes are no more, the silent rose, the songless gondolier. Her palaces are crumbling to the shore, and music meets not always now the ear. Those days are gone, the beauty still is here. States fall, arts fade, but nature doth not die, nor yet forget how Venice once was dear, the present place of all festivity, the revel of the earth, the mask of Italy. But unto us she hath a spell beyond, her name and story and her long array of mighty shadows whose dim forms despond above the Doge-less city vanished away.
That is an unexploded bomb from 1849, when Venice had its revolution against the Austrian domination. And Venice is full of details like that. And so some of my students have to go out and look for little things that speak of the history of this city.
This is Kafurskai, where my boss and I spent a lot of time when we were very young, and we had our MA degree before marrying actually and moving to Boca to get our PhD.